If you're here, you probably use Excel daily and you've developed your go-to routines. Now, after a while, it almost becomes natural, and it's hard to imagine that you're not really doing it the way you should. Let's end that. I collected a few things that many of us are consistently doing wrong. I'm also going to show you then the better way of doing it. Let's take a look. One common mistake is to create external links to files without intending to do that. So if you go to the data tab here and you see that edit links is not grayed out and you click on it and you have a lot of links there that you don't need, you need to clean those up. This was a common thing at my previous company because we copied over many different worksheets from different files to new files. And while we did that, we brought over links that were still referencing the old files, and we never intended to do that. So how can you copy sheets the correct way? Well, let's take a look at this example. We have a start file here, and I have a calculation sheet and a master sheet. Now, in this calculation sheet, we have formulas that reference that master sheet. Now, I want to copy the calculation sheet over to another file that's called local file. In this file, I also have a master sheet, and when I copy over my calculations, I want them to reference this master sheet. Well, let's see how we can do that. I'm going to go back to the start file, right mouse click on the tab here, move or copy, place a check mark to create a copy, and then select local file. So now this is going to bring over the calculation tab to the local file. But the problem is the formulas are still referencing the old file. Notice it has the name of the old file in here. If that's something that you intended, it's fine. In this case, I don't want it to do that. I want it to reference the master tab that I have here. So of course I could go in and update this manually, but assume you have a lot of different formulas here and you don't want to take the risk of doing this manually. What you can do is go and edit the links. You're going to change source and then select the local file as your source. So the file that you copied it to, we're going to select that as the source. So basically it's going to be referencing itself. And once you do that, edit links is grayed out again because you have no more formulas referencing an external file. If you wanted to remove the formulas completely, you can break the links. You can also do that right here under edit links. Next one is something you shouldn't do if you want to enjoy working in Excel. So it's more of a productivity tip. Let's say I'm writing out instructions for this page here, and I notice it's getting too long. I want to break it up into multiple cells. So I'm going to go and say, okay, right after the two here, I want to break that up. That's this two right here. So I'm going to grab that, cut it out, then go to the next cell, paste it in, then take a look at where I need to do the next cut. After this, cut it out, paste it in. And then let's say I forget to write something here, so this cell gets longer and I have to repeat that process. No, don't do this. What you want to do instead is this. Decide where you want that cutoff point to be. For me, it's right after this cell. Just highlight the area until where you think your text is going to flow to, and then go to Home, all the way on this side, select Fill and Justify. That's what you need. Everything automatically adjusts. If you ever want to put all of this back, just make your selection wide enough until where you think it fits in the first line, go back to fill, justify, and everything is back. Next one is merging cells instead of centering them in the wrong places. There is a place to use merge cells, and that's usually on top of your report, but you shouldn't be merging cells in the middle of your datasets. So for example, here I have 2019, 20, and 2021. These cells are merged. If I want to write a function here that sums up these values, I can't just make a selection like this because the merge cells cause my range to automatically expand. What I could do is to go in and manually update this to make sure that this is restricted, or another way would be to manually make my selections. Basically, just highlight this, hold down control, highlight, highlight, and so on. Now, if you have a lot of rows and a lot of merge cells in between, this is going to be a headache. So a better way of handling this is to use center across selections. So I'm just going to unmerge this again just to go back to two separate cells. What you're going to do is select your range the same way you would do if you want to merge, but instead of merging, you're going to right mouse click format cells or use the shortcut key control 1, go to alignment here, change your setting to center across selection, and then click on OK. And this is going to give you the exact same effect, except that you still have two separate cells. So I'm just going to copy this, let's double click this, apply it to this one and this one. Now, if I write my formula again, I can make my selection like I normally would, and I'm not going to run into any problems. Now, I have two tips for you here. One is that you can add alignment settings to your quick access toolbar. You're going to find it under format cells options. When you click this, it's automatically going to take you to here, and you just have to adjust your settings and click on OK. Another tip is if you want to find out what cells are merged, so let's just merge this one, let's merge this one. Now, you are looking for merged cells in your workbook, you can use the find feature. So just press Control F, decide on whether you want to do your search within the sheet or within the whole workbook, and then click on format here. Decide on the format that you're looking for. Here, we just want to look for merged cells, and then click on OK. And then we can find next. We're going to see this. It's going to find the other one. You can find all. You can select them. You'll see them selected here. You can add a color just so you can locate them better. Close this and then go and update the formatting and make it center across selection. Next one is poor file structure. I often see files where everything is condensed and thrown in the same sheet. So we have the source data on this side, we have calculations in the middle, and then we have some graphics on this side. Don't put everything on the same sheet. Instead, split it into separate tabs. So you're going to have a separate dashboard or report tab. You can have a separate calculation tab and a separate tab for your source data in case it's coming in from Excel. So in this case, the source data is coming in from Power Query and from the data model, so we don't keep it separately in Excel. But we keep the calculations separately, then these flow in to the dashboard side. You might want to add instructions and a tab where you control the changes that you make to your file. You can also add different colors to make things easier to find or as a way of visually grouping certain tabs together. Next one is about hiding rows and columns in the wrong places. So generally, it's better to group rows and columns instead of hiding them. Why? Well, let's take a look at this example. So let's say you receive this from your colleague and you quickly want to get the total value for sales. So you just jump to the bottom here and you do a quick sum. Let's just highlight everything and grab our number and then we report this to our boss. Problem is, this number is wrong. Why? Because if I select these numbers, the sum of these equals 167,000, not the number that I have here. Why am I seeing this? Well, my colleague has hidden some rows here. If I select this, right mouse click and unhide, that's what they've done. They've actually done a data preparation for their chart on the bottom of this data set. I didn't see it because I didn't really have any visual indication that things were hidden. If you look carefully, you will see it. So if I go and hide these again, notice we see these two very light lines there. This is a visual indication that something was hidden. So if I also select all of these, you can see that better. A better visual cue is to group cells instead of hiding them. So let's just go ahead and unhide. To group this information together, you just need to select it and use the shortcut key Shift-Alt, the right arrow key. You can also add subgroupings. Just make your selection, Shift-Alt, right arrow key. You can get to it from the menu as well. If you go to the Data tab, under Outline here, you have Group and Ungroup. There is a shortcut key to ungroup as well. It's Shift-Alt and the left arrow key. To ungroup these, Shift-Alt, left arrow key. The grouping makes it more obvious that something has been grouped together because if I collapse this, I can see that box here and it makes it more obvious that something is hidden than just those thin double lines there. Now, a better practice when you're doing such an exercise is anyhow to split your calculations in a separate tab than to have everything in the same tab. Next common mistake is to input values or hardcode values in your formulas. This is especially difficult to track in the more complex models. So for example, here, I have a financial model where I'm deciding on whether it's worth it to invest in a new printing press or not. Down here, I'm using a discount factor. Now, I expect this discount factor to flow into my model, but if I click on the side here, it's not using it. 6% has been hard-coded in this formula, so maybe someone came in and decided to test stuff out, and they just input directly the value in the formula. Now, these are difficult to track. One way to see where this is flowing to is to just select a cell, go to Formulas, and click on Trace Dependence. So now I can see the discount factor, so this cell is going in to this calculation here. It's not going into here. I can also do it the other way around. I can go to this cell and trace precedence. This one is not going here. Let's go and remove the arrows. So the right way of doing this is to have a cell where you input your value, in this case, the 8%, and then we're going to do a cell reference here. So we're going to reference this one. And since I want to drag the formula, I'm going to fix the referencing by clicking on F4. And now we can drag this to the side. And now everything is consistent. So if I want to change this, I'm going to update this to 6%, and everything updates accordingly. Now, if you have values that don't change, so for example, you want to divide something by 7 because you have 7 days in a week, or by 24 because you have 24 hours in a day. Those ones you can hard code in your formulas. But values that might change, like a discount factor here, is something that you want to have in a separate cell, and then make sure your other formulas are referencing that cell. Next one is not taking advantage of tables. So if you have a dataset like this, turning it into a table is what you need if you want your chart to update automatically once you get new data, if you want your formulas to update automatically once you have new lines added, and if you want your pivot tables or your formatting to update automatically as well. If you don't turn this into a table, you have to make those updates yourself manually, which you don't want to do. So let's turn this into a table by just going to Home and formatting it as a table. You can also use the shortcut key Control T. Here you can decide on the type of format that you want. Let's say I'm going to go with that. It's going to ask me if my table has headers. In this case, it does. So I'm just going to go with OK. And the formatting is automatically applied. If I'm not happy with this formatting and I want to create my own, just select none and then apply the formatting that you want. So let's say I want to get a light blue for the headers and I want this column to be light gray. Now, the moment I get more data added to this, the formatting is going to come with. What about the formulas? If I have a formula here, like a count if formula, and I'm just going to count the division column. So the moment I select division, notice I get table referencing. My criteria here is game. Right now, what should I get? 1, 2, 3, 4, right? The moment I add a new game underneath this table and my table expands, it becomes 5. If I add another one, it becomes 6. If you want to delete these table rows, but you don't want to delete other things that you might have on your file here, you just select the rows that you want. So I'm just going to select these two cells actually, right mouse click, delete, and delete the table rows. So not the rows of the actual workbook, but the table rows. Notice these didn't get deleted and my table got smaller. So this is where I know the table ends. That's that little marker on the bottom right hand side. If you have a chart based on this data, it's also going to update automatically. So we can quickly check that. Let's insert a column chart here. That last one is squids with 100. We don't see anything. Let's just increase that to 3000. Now I'm just going to add a new one here. I can automatically see that. Let's put 5000 and my chart updates automatically. I don't have to worry about expanding chart ranges. It's done because I'm using a table. Okay, so that's my list of common Excel things a lot of us go about the wrong way. and my suggestions on how you can improve. So I hope you found some new techniques here. Let me know in the comments. If you enjoyed this video, hit that thumbs up, subscribe if you aren't subscribed yet, and I'm gonna see you in the next video.